Yeah,
one more.
Let's go.
Finish strong now. Leave all in here.
Jab and knee. Come on, big knee.
Big finish.
Hey, come on, finish it in. Back me up.
Karyn Bryant for MMA H.E.A.T. I'm here with Quinton Rampage Jackson. We came down to Rampage Fitness Academy, the new and improved. So it's a great, you may as well plug it. Where is it? Where are we? We're in Laguna Hills?
We're in Laguna Hills.
All right. Well, it's nice. It's a nice spot.
Thank you.
So you're looking good. You've got a fight coming up May 17th against King Mo. I honestly, you hear fighters say all the time, oh, I'm in the best shape of my life or whatever. But literally, when you walked in, Quinton, you look good. You look real good.
Thank you.
Jeez, so here we go. All right.
You haven't never said it like that.
I will. All right. How you? Oh my goodness.
Hey now.
I keep forgetting.
I keep forgetting. What have you been doing different? Because in all honesty, you look a lot more lean, and you're moving a lot faster in there. What's different?
Well, the main thing is that I'm back enjoying what I'm doing, and because it don't hurt as much. Yeah. I fixed a lot of the injuries that I had, and I'm just doing extra stuff in the gym and not cheating as much on my diet. And just training really hard. I'm really motivated. But I think half the reason why I'm motivated because I really want to shut Mo up and is close to my hometown. You know, a lot of my friends and family are going to be there. A lot of my family members that never came to any of my fights are going to be there.
What is it about Mo that really sets you off? Why does he bother you?
The thing about Mo that bothers me the much is that his mouth, you know, he kind of disrespected me years ago when he didn't even know me personally. He didn't know what type of person I am or I was back then. And he just said some stuff that made me kind of look at him like, man, who the hell is this guy? I didn't know who he was when he first started mouthing off on me. But the main thing that I will never forget is he told me he wanted to fight me when I was on my way out. So when I was like, sometimes fighters fight past their prime,
yep,
and it's time for them to leave the sport, but you know what I'm saying, their ego won't let them leave. Mm-hmm. And so we're not as good as we used to be, but we still out there fighting and something. He said that's when he wanted to fight me. I was like, it showed me a little bit about his character, and it kind of irked me a little bit, and that's why I really want to shut him up.
Yeah. Do you think he's, obviously I'm sure you do think he's beatable. How is he beatable? What have you seen in his last fights that makes you confident you can beat him?
Well, you know, I feel like it's not really what he's doing or what he's been doing his last fight. It's just me. When I train right and I train hard and I'm motivated, I think it's hard to stop me.
Yeah.
So I don't think he can put up with anything that I'm going to be able to dish out.
And do you think you still have it? I mean, obviously you look like you're in great shape. Do you feel that your speed is still there? You feel you still have the same power that you've always had? Because you mentioned something in there and you said, I haven't felt this good of cardio, you know, since Pride. So I'm guessing you still feel like the old Rampage.
Yeah, I feel like my speed is still there. And I feel like if I'm mentally motivated to, you know, put up a good high pace and to be fast and to be powerful, I think I still can do that.
Yeah.
I feel like it hasn't left. My speed hasn't left yet. And my power most definitely hasn't left. They say your power is the last thing to go. Speed is the first thing to go. But you know, I'm not like a known to be a fast guy anyway.
Yeah.
So I was never known to be a very, you know, fast
only
guy.
With the ladies.
Only with the ladies. Oh yeah. How she know? How you know about that?
Yeah, I've heard. We have a collective thing. All the girls we talk. You know?
Oh, real?
Yeah.
They talk about me like that?
You know.
I just be joking around. I don't just be really trying to.
We know, Quinton, that you don't always love fighting wrestlers, though. And Mo does have that wrestling background. I mean, not that you don't, because obviously you know how to wrestle, too. But stylistically, do you think it's a good matchup for you?
I think, honestly, I think it is a good matchup because A lot of people know that I've been having problems with wrestlers in the past, but only time I've been having problems with wrestlers is when my knees wasn't good and I couldn't wrestle in training camps. And, you know, I don't come out and say it in my interview, oh, I hope this guy don't wrestle me because my knees didn't bother me for the last couple of years and that's why I've been wrestling. I don't ever say that.
Yeah.
So I just go out there and fight and I just try my best, and sometimes my wrestling is not that good because I haven't made wrestle, but I've been able to wrestle this whole training camp, so I don't see his wrestling being a problem for me at all.
So you've won two fights in Bellator. I know initially you were supposed to fight Tito. That didn't happen. Is that a fight you still want? Is that something you'd like to come back around to?
I never really wanted to fight Tito, but, you know, it was my first fight in Bellator, and Tito signed on. I kind of took it as a smack to the face. I wish Tito would have came later. Like, the deal that I did with Viacom and Bellator, I figured, like, a lot of the fighters, when they got wind of it, when they understood the deal I did, maybe they might come over and stuff. But Tito was the first one to come over. I didn't know he was going to come over so soon.
Yeah.
But I didn't know why Bellator wanted him to fight me right away. And, you know, it was going to...
A lot of us questioned that. Because why would you take two big stars and give one a loss right away? It didn't seem like the greatest business idea, but
I can't help but agree with you with that. And I just feel like sometimes, you know, everybody don't think the same. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I like Bellator and I like Bjorn. I like what those guys do over there. So I said, okay, all right, which I'll fight him. I really never really did want to fight him, but I was telling Tito, he made, you know, I called him on the phone and said, man, you made a mistake, man, because, you know, this is time for me to make a statement. Yeah. And whoever I get in the cage with, I'm going to knock him out. And I knew I was going to knock him out. And, you know, saying Tito, he was going to have to get hurt.
Yeah. So it's okay if you guys never actually fight, though?
I'm okay with Tito never stepping in the cage with him. I'm okay with it. Cause I like Tito now, especially since he has the little injuries and stuff like that. I will feel bad if I hurt him further. Yeah.
Well, you did talk about knocking. Your first fight was Joey Beltran, then he stepped up. And I remember talking to you after that fight, because you were sort of apologetic for the way that you spoke to him after you knocked him out, right?
Yeah, who, Beltran?
Beltran, yeah. Because I remember before the thing, and he kind of said, what happened? Because he kind of started talking a little smack, and then he said, what happened? And then you said you got knocked the F out.
Yeah,
and then afterwards you said, well, I probably shouldn't have said that.
Yeah, it was... That was kind of like out of my character a little bit, but, you know, I went to go shake his hand, congratulate him, because I felt like Joey was a man. He took the fight on short notice, and he fought me. He didn't run around, and he didn't really try to, like, take me down and, you know,
so he's a banger. That's what he does.
Yeah, so I had respect for him. Then he didn't shake my hand. He was like, what happened? And then I got kind of upset.
Yeah,
so
he did.
That was, I felt bad after I said it later. But then I watched it, like, later. It was kind of funny.
It was entertaining, I have to say. No offense to Joey, but it was, and you could read, and because after, I remember you said, how do you know what I said? I said, well, Quinton, you could read it right on, you know, you could read your lips right on there, and it was, it was a moment, let's just put it that way.
Yeah, it was kind of bad. I should have watched what I said.
Yeah, it was a slightly unsportsmanly, but, you know, these things happen.
When you're in a cage and you got gloves on and you fight, like, I think we can get away with a lot more stuff than, like, other sports, people can, you know.
So what did you feel about the win over Christian Mpumbu, right? That's how we say his name, right? So
I don't know. I never figured out how you say his name.
Well, how do you feel about your performance in that and Joey, I guess? Because now you're on a two-fight streak. So how are you feeling about what you did?
Oh, if I'm going to be brutally honest, I have to say that, you know, it's a good thing that I those two guys, I had to finish them as fast as possible. You know, They're great fighters. I think what's his name? Pabudu?
Mpumbu.
Papu. Yeah. That guy.
He, Christian. Let's call him Christian.
Yeah. Why we don't call him Christian?
I don't know.
I never. That whole time I didn't figure it out. I should have been calling him Christian.
Christian.
Because
I
can say that.
Yes.
Christian and I. He was former champion of Bellator. I had never seen him fight before. I fought him. I never heard him. I just knew, like, come on, I got to knock this guy out right away. And Beltran, he took the fight on short notice and stuff like that. I'm like, man, I got to knock this guy out right away. And if I didn't, it would have looked bad on my behalf. Yeah. I'm not talking bad about those two guys, but this is where I put it in my head. Like, these two guys, they, I should knock these guys out right away.
Well, and that's what your fans want. That's what, you know, the Rampage fans are looking for.
Yeah, they're looking for knockouts or slams or both.
Do you watch your old footage, your old tapes and stuff?
Not that much anymore. Like when I come home, like I show my kids.
Yeah.
And I don't watch it.
What do they say? I mean, what's their reaction when they look at the like old pride fights, for example?
Who, my kids?
Yeah.
They like it. They think it's cool. They like it. Some of the things they think it's cool.
Yeah.
Some of my kids don't care. They like, oh, whatever.
Because no matter what, kids are kids. Sometimes it doesn't matter what their parents do. Sometimes they're over it. They don't care.
They're playing on an iPad and so they're like, oh, that's cool.
Let's go.
Try that shit with me.
All right. But you do. You said a minute ago that one of your kids maybe wants to fight. Maybe does.
Yeah.
Maybe doesn't.
Yeah. Roger wants to fight. He trains. He says he wants to fight. So he trains, but. He's like the way I used to be. He wants to fight, but he's not too happy about the training part. I'm like, you gotta train.
But the apple, Quinton, you're the tree. Yeah. There's the apple right there. You don't love the training part all the time either.
No, but that's one thing about me though. People didn't understand when people mistook me saying I hate to train. They mistook that means that I don't train. I train very hard. Even when I hated to train, I still train very hard. But I just hated it. It wasn't like I wasn't happy, but I was in a bad mood when I had to go do it. But look like he don't want to do it at all.
No.
Who is he? But I'm not going to force him. I'm not going to push him into it.
Those big shoes to fill. Obviously, if I'm fighting, I mean, you know, did you at least give him a nickname or anything yet?
Well, no. He you know, all my kids, their middle name is Rampage.
So, oh, okay. So, really?
Yeah.
You have a daughter, too, though.
Yeah, but her middle name is Paige.
Okay. Oh, just Paige. That's cute.
Yeah, but she don't like it because she knows that I really wanted to name her Rampage. her mama saved her.
Rampage is so black, though, Quinton. It's not a good name.
I'm black, though.
But listen, you've never, when have you seen the CEO? Oh, well, welcome our new CEO of the company, Rampage. That's
but
not going
to
happen.
She didn't have to use it because her name is Nanami Lakia Rampage. It would have been Rampage.
Okay.
But her name is Nanami Lakia Page.
Okay.
Jackson. So she wouldn't have to use a Rampage.
Yeah, Rampage.
It's just been like when I see her, I'm like, hey, Rampage. If I call her that now, she bursts out crying and yelling.
It's not great.
I know, she didn't.
It's not a great name.
Yeah, her mom's really happy that he didn't actually name her. Because she's already changed her first name. Her name is Nanami.
Yeah.
And Americans call her Nanami.
Okay. Because she's part Japanese.
Yeah, she's part Japanese.
Right.
So she done pretty much changed her name to Nanami.
Nanamana. Do you
All right, no. Say your name right. Your name is Nanami.
Nanami, right.
Nanami. And so she changed Nanami. I'm like, no, that's not your name. She can't even say that around me. So I'm worried about her changing her whole name.
Do something. But I guarantee you it won't be Rampage. It'll be Paige.
She don't like Paige. She don't like Paige. But yeah, she probably changed that part of her name.
Well, what can you do? They're kids. I want to clear something up. You know, we were talking about the deal that you signed. People, you've got probably a couple more fights with Bellator.
Yeah, I think so.
Right. But when you've signed, initially it had said you were also going to be doing pro wrestling.
Yeah.
And there was that kind of some confusion. People weren't really sure. Were you going to be a pro wrestler? Were you going to be fighting? So what, you know, what's the line? Are you going to actually be doing more things with TNA? Will you actually get in there and compete with them too? What's up?
Well, yeah, I was supposed to be doing some pro wrestling and stuff with TNA. And, you know, I did a deal with Viacom. People, it's just hard for people to understand. They just think I just signed strictly to Bellator. I was supposed to be doing movies and
right.
some TV shows and fight for them and do TNA wrestling. But I have to train. I have to train more for pro wrestling, but I've just been fighting back to back.
Yeah.
And sometimes I could tell, like TNA, they want me to train while I'm training for a fight. Right now, I can't do both.
Right.
I can't. There's no way I can do both.
Because you can legitimately get hurt of doing that.
Pro wrestling is tougher than MMA. I don't know why people don't understand it. What people don't understand about pro wrestling, they just say, oh, it's fake. I think, honestly, the only thing that probably is fake about pro wrestling is probably the outcome most of the time. But when it gets scripted, but if a guy gets hurt in there,
that's real hurt.
That's real. So right. How are you gonna win a match if he hurt? So I don't think it's as fake as people think it is because everything hurts. When you run to the ropes, when you hit those ropes, they hurt.
Yeah.
You gotta train your body to get used to that.
So is that something though that you could transition into after fighting though, or would you just not want to deal with like that kind of injury?
Yeah, what I would do is I would just let people know, like, I'm a certain type of pro wrestler.
Okay, yeah, I'm not the one that's going to be
flinging around. I'm not the one
that's
going to be doing
it. Yeah.
I ain't going to be doing, you know, you ain't going to be doing any crazy. I like to entertain people.
Right.
And I like pro wrestling because it's fun. I always wanted to be a pro wrestler. I never wanted to be an MMA fighter. I didn't know about MMA.
Okay, right.
I was a pro wrestling fan. I wasn't an MMA fan. You know, it's different. That's why, you know, saying I am the way I am.
So how did you even ever get convinced then to be an MMA fighter?
Well, one of my friends, Dave Roberts, the guy, the co-owner of this gym, he was the one doing martial arts and fighting in Memphis. And, you know, he knew I wrestled in college, and I wrestled him in high school. So he wanted me to help him train for a fight.
And from there?
From there, and then...
And is it the type of thing where you threw a punch and you realized, dang, I've been fighting here?
No, I've been fighting my whole life on the street.
Yeah.
I've always been a fighter. I'm basically a street fighter.
Right.
But I was helping him train for a fight, and we was training with Jeff Mullen down in Memphis, and the champion, his name, Mike Powell,
mm-hmm.
he was champion of Memphis then, and his opponent fell out with like 3 days' notice or something. They said,
You want to do it?
You want to do it? I'm like, oh, okay, I've been training. So I went there, and I ended up beating him by decision.
Right.
So he was the best guy in Memphis. He was undefeated. So and he was like a jiu-jitsu purple belt, and that was unheard of in Memphis. And he was like, man, you a natural fighter. Go and fight.
Right,
so I'm like, oh, okay, I'll do it. So I just started fighting. I started training. I moved to California, trained with Fabiano Ehab and Dave. And I turned to a fighter.
And from there, you know what? I met your dad at the last fight when you were supposed to fight. When Chandler and Alvarez were fighting, I met your dad. Mm-hmm. Has he always been supportive of what you did, or were there times when maybe he was like, you know, I don't know, I want you to do something else?
Yeah, he was always supportive. My family, they was always happy. They was always supportive. Like I said, I've been fighting my whole life,
yeah.
And they're not surprised. No one in my family is surprised I turned out to be a professional fighter. They're not surprised at all.
So that's cool. So like you said, they'll be at the fights, and you have a lot of family, other families that have seen you fight.
My whole family there, I'm guarantee you, that's the worst thing about me fighting there. Everybody's going to want to go, and everybody's going to want a ticket. Even if the tickets were $2, nobody would want to buy one.
Why?
Because I'm your cousin. Nigga. I got to give them a ticket and all their friends. You know what I'm saying?
At least they'll throw you a big barbecue the next day, though, right?
Yeah, that's what that was the plan. Is the plan is they want to throw a barbecue, but I still got to pay for it.
Yeah, your win bonus.
Yeah. What win bonus?
Yeah. You know, I have a question about Memphis. I went there. I went with Wade. You know that Wade is a white gentleman. Yeah. People gave us a lot of grief about being in an
interracial relationship.
And this was some years ago.
How many years ago was this?
It was 8 years ago or so. I mean, it's been a little while, but still, it's 8 years, Quinton, but it's still, like, in the grand scheme of things,
it's the South.
Fresh still.
It's the South. It's, if you guys go there, people will still, you will still hear comments. I mean, the first time I dated a white girl, I took her to the mall, and we was holding hands, and her mom did not like it at all.
Uh-uh.
Her mom was like, but she was a spoiled little brat, and she got away with it. But I heard the black girls, I got really good hearing. They was like, I just know he didn't. And he just walking around his mall with this white girl. I was like, yes.
Yeah.
That's back when I was about 17 back then. 17,
yeah.
I was 17, 18 back then. So it was back a while ago, but.
Well, and that's what I'm saying. It was not white people that gave me grief about it.
No, they wouldn't be as loud about it.
Yeah,
you understand?
Yeah.
They give you grief.
Yeah, I know. But
they won't come to your face with it.
Right.
They ain't gonna come to your face with it. But the black people, they ain't shy.
I know. They also came over and they told me to straighten my hair. I had people little come over to me and interrupt me during dinner, and you know, first thing you're like, oh, cool, they want an autograph, you know, because I'm like, yeah, I got it going on, and they're all like, yeah, what's you know, first they say, are you black? And I said, well, a little of this, a little of that, a little of this, and then they said, oh, well, we don't do this, and they pointed to us with the relationship, and then they go, and we don't wear our hair like that, and I was like, are you kidding?
This is what you would tell me, like,
I'm eating dinner.
I'm not you. I'm not from here. I'm not you.
I was crazy. I don't know. I'm bringing this up because there's nothing you can do to fix
but
I wanted to understand it because it was really surprising to me.
Yeah, you know, I've over the years and stuff, I've really learned to like just laugh at ignorant people and stuff like that. It's funny though, but you know, I grew up in the South, then now I live in Orange County, which is totally different. It's the same a little bit, but but kind of different.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So it's just like. And like in the South, you wouldn't be used to a black woman dating a white girl. Most times you would see a black man dating a white girl. So you don't see it the other way around that often.
Well, people have seen the NBA, so they know what happens.
Yeah, yeah. They know what happens. But people need to mind their own business.
Yeah, of course.
That's what the bottom line. Like, what I feel like, your soulmate may not be your race.
Yeah.
That's what I feel. You know what I'm saying? What is race? And you know what I'm saying? The same thing, like, what is religion? Just another way we can be prejudiced against each other. One day, you know what I'm saying, we should all understand that we are all one. We're all the same thing. All our souls, all our energy comes from the same source. We are all one. We are all connected. And you know what I'm saying? Our the color of our skin is just, you know what I'm saying, is a shell of the body that our soul, that our energy source is in. We are all one. And people just need to stop being prejudiced. I just learned to look at it and laugh.
You believe you have a soulmate out there somewhere? Because I know that you have sampled, and you've been looking, Quinton. You've been looking.
I'm not really looking. I don't know if I'm really looking for my soulmate because.
Yeah.
But I do now. I do believe in a soulmate thing. Yeah. Before I was like, that's like cheesy stuff like that.
Right.
I don't know. I'm not looking for my soulmate, but I do believe. I'm a very spiritual person now.
Yes, yes.
So I do believe there might be a soulmate out there. It might be somebody that.
Right.
Yeah, that you just connect with on this.
Sure. Sure.
And it could be your soulmate, and just because some people don't believe in stuff, that don't mean it's not real, right?
Yeah, right.
So I usually didn't believe in a lot of stuff. That don't mean it's not real. And now I believe in reincarnation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, I always have. You're just coming around.
I'm just coming around too. Because too many things like
sure.
And they're doing so many studies like hypnotize people and mm-hmm. stuff like that, and they doing too much stuff. So now I believe, and even Jesus talked about being born again.
Yeah.
He's talking about being born again, but some people want to say, he's talking about being born again to religion, which now since I'm older, it don't really make sense.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think there's more to this world than meets the eye, and maybe they are like soulmates. Maybe you probably used to be soulmates in another life.
He's about to drop the camera.
many moons ago.
You found one that was almost right?
No, I found a girl that was just like me.
Yeah.
That was bad.
Yeah, I was just gonna say that's too much.
That was too much. Yeah. I thought she was my soulmate because I liked being close to her.
Yeah.
I didn't know what that stuff meant and stuff like that, but she didn't feel the same way about me.
Oh, right.
And I was like, well, what's wrong with you, girl? I'm the shit. What's wrong with you? But she was too much like me, and I saw her like, man, this girl's too much like me.
Yeah.
Too much.
That'd be dangerous.
That was dangerous.
Yeah.
And then now, the other girl, she said, I'm her soulmate. And now, like, I had that bad taste in my mouth with her, so I'm like, I don't know if I'm with this soulmate stuff, but like I said, I do believe in it a little bit.
But I know for a fact nobody's hypnotizing you to find your past lives because you won't even tap instead of going out, right? You're like, listen, I don't need to be unconscious around anybody.
Right, right, yeah, yeah. Like I don't let nobody put me unconscious and stuff like that. But I might let somebody hypnotize me because I am interested in it because I do think I'm a reincarnated pharaoh.
Yeah.
I do think that for some reason.
Do you find that you have an affinity for Egyptian things all of a sudden? You can't explain why.
I just can't explain why, but it's always like little small coincidences, and then I've learned not to believe in coincidences. Because I'm from Memphis,
mm-hmm.
and Memphis, my hometown, was named after the Memphis in Egypt.
Yep.
And then I ended up wrestling for the school called Rally Egypt,
mm-hmm.
and our mascot was a pharaoh.
Yeah.
And you know what I'm saying? So I'm a pharaoh right there. And then my family does construction, and we help build like a pyramid in Memphis.
Uh-huh.
And that's why I tattooed this pyramid on me right here.
Cool.
With the chain and stuff like that. And like little small things I'm not going to go into, but it always points back.
Coming back.
It always points back to Egypt.
Have you been?
Never been. I want to go so bad.
You should go.
Why? I want to go.
Yeah.
I want to go before they stop people from going to the pyramid.
Yeah, I was just going to say, they're not
I just never had time, and you know, I'm going to go one day.
I want to move on to your fighting promotion. We had a lot of things hanging around here.
Oh,
you've had some fights next weekend. Why did you want to be a promoter? Why now?
Well, you know what? To keep it 100, it's a lot of shows going on, and I see a lot of people coming up doing amateur shows and everything, but how many people are really for the fighters?
Mm-hmm.
And you know what I'm saying? I know how it is out there, and I want to do amateur shows, and I want to teach the fighters the positive side of about fight. I want to teach them how to do interviews. I want to get the most exciting fighters and build them up and have them get a lot of good experience so they can go into the shows. Mm-hmm. with the number of fights. A lot of time guys go into the shows and they just use, even the guys that just using them and throwing them out. You know what I'm saying? The guys go to the show, they go to the big show. I'm not gonna say anybody names. Yeah. And you think that they're gonna do good, and these guys, they should clearly they should promote this guy. Cause mm-hmm. this guy, he has charisma, he's exciting and stuff like that, but they throw him to the wolves and he lose one, two fights and they throw him away and you never see him again. And a lot of times they lose their first big fight because they're not used to the right. You know, they're not used to all that.
So you're trying to help shape these kids and get them ready for the big time.
Getting ready for the big time, and I'm going to teach them how they should be treated, and so they know their worth when they get up there to the show. Now they already have like a following because mm-hmm. I'm going to start doing fights and live streaming over the internet. So these guys that know their they know about their following. Social media is so mm-hmm. big, and I help them build their social media up. And so they know their network when they come to the big show. So the guys can't just give them $2,000 and go out there and just throw them to the wolves and then throw them away. And because now with all the UFC gyms, these fighters, they go to the fights and they get used up, and the only thing they had to do is come back home and open up a gym.
Yeah.
And you know, but now they can't even do that because they got to compete with the UFC gym down the street. Mm-hmm. And these guys, now they can't make a living at all. Or what they're going to do, go teach at the UFC gym and work for somebody else, and when they could own their own gym and be an entrepreneur and make...
Yeah, I think it's a valuable lesson for people to learn how to manage them. Right, that's the problem, I guess, with the sport. I mean, you see it in every sport. Young guys making money and not knowing how to spend it or save it, invest it, that kind of thing is an issue. But so, how many fighters do you have on this card? How many fights are going down? This is May 10th.
Yeah.
Next Saturday, May 10th, that you'll be doing this.
Yeah, well, we have like eight fights, and we're gonna have a few exhibitions. This is our first show, so we're just going to let the word get out there and mm-hmm. show people what we're gonna do, and hopefully. The first show go according to plan, and just me learning how to promote and stuff is always, I'm gonna be commentating me and Mayhem.
Mayhem, right? Because you've been, it's funny, I've seen a lot of pictures you guys have been sharing. He's been training with you.
Yeah.
How's he doing? Because people wonder about Mayhem, you know? Yeah. Things got a little dicey with him.
Listen, the guy's name is Mayhem. It sounds
and
up.
we're surprised when stuff goes weird.
Don't
right?
be surprised when stuff goes weird.
Yeah.
Mayhem is one of the coolest, most positive guys I know. I've been training with him for a long time. We just took a break from each other because he went his way and I went my way. But I'm telling you guys, when I was training with Mayhem back in the day, that's when I was smashing people.
Yeah.
That's the reason why people were surprised that I beat Marilla Bustamante and stuff like that and Ricardo Arona, and they were like black belts. So I'm like, because I trained with Mayhem. His jiu-jitsu is good. Now I got a ton of black legs with his awesome jiu-jitsu practitioner, but I don't like to roll with Tom because he's so good. I can't do anything.
Yeah, right.
He's like a roll with Mayhem, and the way his style, I can, you know, he keeps going and just his style. He's really good, and he's trained with Mo. And Mayhem's trained with half of
MMA. He's training with Mo and with you?
He's trained with Mo.
Oh, has in the past.
He has trained with Mo, and he knows. One thing about Mayhem, he knows people, and mm-hmm. he knows, and he can mimic anybody. He's like an MMA chameleon.
Yeah.
But the guy,
and he's stable? I mean, because seriously, people got really worried about him.
Like same thing. Like, look, I messed up before. You know, we all have, like, stuff when we have problems. But right now, his most... current problem is some girl lied and say he beat her up or something, and that's what's wrong with our world today. Like right now, if I'm dating a girl right now, mm-hmm. she can get mad at me for being who I am, and she catch me with another girl, and she can say anything she want, and I'm guilty until proven innocent.
Right.
And that's what's going on right now. You know, a girl can say anything. He's in court right now, and now that mess up his way to make a living. How is this guy going to feed himself? How is he going to do this if people keep blackballing off something that's not proven yet?
And certainly as a professional fighter, it's very easy to convince people that you guys do bad things.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And Mayhem, he don't lie to me about it. He don't got to lie to me.
Yeah.
He would have told me, I'm like, hey, I asked him straight up, but just me and him, nobody else. I said, hey, did you beat that girl up? He was like, no, man. He don't lie to me about something. Mayhem, we start off a team punishment together. Mm-hmm. We have, me and Mayhem has a totally different relationship than anybody else because he knows me. Like, one person that really knows me is Mayhem. He knows what type of person I am. Like, I won't say nothing. I won't say nothing. And he knows I keep it real. he knows if I said, like, yeah, I'm not going to say nothing, he know I'm not going to say nothing. And he honestly told me, he said, no, man, the girl caught me cheating on her. And so she telling everybody, she got other cases where she did with her ex, too. She did, this her MO, that's what she did. This type of stuff she do. But I'm an MMA fighter, and everybody jumping on it, blah, 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 and my name is Mayhem. So people can keep blackballing him if they want, but he's my friend, and I really know him. Yeah. I won't blackball him. I think we have a good time commentating, and hopefully the Conquest MMA grow, and I can build up a lot of amateur fighters, and I want to get behind like the most exciting ones, the ones that got the most charisma, and just, you know, I'll get behind them, they can come train with me and do whatever, and I'm just happy to see kids grow up in this sport I love and keep it going, because MMA is evolved so fast and it's getting watered down. And
you think it is getting watered down?
I feel
how so?
Right now, like back in the day, you know what I'm saying, when I first started fighting, it was a lot of fighters there. It was a lot of people were excited. You was excited about seeing the fights. Now it's fights on almost every day, and they got so many fighters, and now nobody's really standing out. Not that many characters, and people are more athletes than they are fighters.
See, that's what I was going to get to, because some people believe that the fact that fighters train from, you know, 16 years old now in all these disciplines, that they're becoming, you know, point fighters, and they know how to win, you know, on technically, they're technically very good, but they don't have that same kind of, you know, yeah, fire, that I guess is what you're kind of talking about. But at the same time, it being perfected could also be argued to be a good thing for how it plays out.
Well, everybody's different. Everybody had their different opinions.
Yeah.
But look at boxing right now. Like, you watch boxing right now, I only watch Mayweather and Pacquiao, and still I don't see them knocking people out all the time.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
I like to see, you know, even though I'm a fighter, like some people say, oh, it's bad, you want to see people get knocked out. But that's why I watch fights.
Yeah,
you want to see people get finished. You want to see exciting fights. I don't want to see people point fighting each other and try to just outpoint each other and say, I'm the one. Look at boxing. They fight round and round like, oh, I think I won six rounds. Let me take off two rounds. I don't want to see that. It's a fight. Like back in the day, you used to watch MMA because when they locked that cage, the two guys, they went at it and they try to finish each other. But now you got these guys that's fighting, like, one guy's trying to outpoint the guy because, you know, it's America. The American fans, they like, who's winning, who's winning, who's winning. It's not about who exciting. Like, these guys, you know, other countries, like China's getting ready to put on fights.
For
Brazil
sure.
is coming up. All these other countries, like Russia, everybody's coming up. These guys, they might not all be American stock fighters. They might end up going fighting all over different worlds. I want to get behind fighters that's kind of like me, has charisma, who can go beyond fighting, who can maybe go and do movies, and who can go and hold a TV show. Because MMA is getting really big, but at the same time, it's not a lot of people that really stands out in MMA. It's not a lot of people that's really marketable that can do other stuff outside of MMA, and that's what I want to change. I want to change the game up a little bit.
And you've always been okay with your losses as long as you felt that you were putting on a show.
Right. Yeah. I know for a fact that, you know what I'm saying, everybody can't win every fight. Sometimes somebody has to lose. As long as it was an exciting fight, I feel like I did my job. I'm always trying my hardest to win. But if I walk away with a loss, I'm not going to, you know what I'm saying, beat myself up about it. On time, if I feel like I could have done better. But me, it's about excitement. If I would have just said, you know what, I'm going to do whatever I got to do, just win every last one of these fights, I probably wouldn't be as popular as I am today. I've been a boring fighter like a lot of other fighters out there. I'm not going to say their name.
So every now and then the A-Team comes on cable and we get to see a rerun. So I think you said you're going to be doing another film this summer?
Yeah, I'm supposed to be doing this movie called Wetlands in Louisiana. With a group of guys, and I'm gonna start working with these people.
Yeah.
A lot. I like the way they do business and stuff like that. So it's like a fun movie. I get to be like a detective and stuff.
Oh,
like
really?
That. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. So we're gonna see you like in a suit and all.
Maybe,
you know,
I'm not gonna. Maybe, who knows? I haven't seen wardrobe and all
that. Yeah.
But who knows? I might be wearing some cool stuff.
Yeah.
I like films like this where I get to, you know what I'm saying, I get to do some action, I get to shoot and, you know, kick ass and stuff like that.
Yeah. Well, it seems like that's what you would be made for.
Yeah, that's tough.
That and something with a little bit of, like, comedic, you know, a little bit of a comedy on the side.
Yeah, I would love to show, you know what I'm saying, my funny side, because I don't get a chance to have that much fun sometimes. I would love for people to cast me in, like, a comedy role. I would love to do a film with somebody like Kevin Hart or something like that.
Oh, it'd be great.
Yeah, because he's funny, man.
Yeah, he is very funny.
Yeah.
He's funny.
He's funny.
Well, Quinton, it's great to see you. Like I said, I'm, you know, it's been too long. We haven't seen you in a long time,
yeah,
so I'm glad.
Well, you know where I live. You can
see. I do.
Just don't bring the cameraman.
Right, right. He's going out of town. That's when I'm supposed to let you know that.
Yeah,
hey.
Hey.
We're going to get the kids. It's a play date.
It's a play date.
Yeah, okay.
But we put the kids in another room. Like, y'all go outside, go swimming.
You are funny. I love what you said on Craig Ferguson the other day. He said, oh, no, you said I've been being good. I've been with the same girl every night. He said, the same girl every night? You said, almost. And just like the way you delivered it was kind of great because yeah. I'm always wondering about the girls at home. Like, yeah, that's me. Like, yeah. Almost.
You see, know? Any girl that I date, they know my personality. They know I like to joke around. So they don't take that stuff too seriously. Plus, yeah.
But she's going through your phone. You know that.
No, she is not going through my phone. She is not going to do much. She know better.
That's good. That's good.
She don't want to see stuff that she shouldn't see. She know better not to.
So it's her fault. Yeah, it's her fault if she sees something she's not supposed to see.
I can go through her phone.
Okay. Oh, really?
Yeah, I can go through her phone, but she can't go through my phone. I don't play that. No way. I'm alpha.
Yes.
Right.
We have determined that you're alpha.
Right.
Yeah.
So she knows. She knows what she can do and what she can't do.
All right.
But she's not allowed to watch my interviews and stuff like that. Is she going to take it like serious?
Yeah, yeah.
But you know, sometimes it don't be them, it be their friends that tell themselves like, oh, your man this, your man that, your man this. And I'm like, okay, you let your friends break us up?
Right.
Because I keep them happy. I keep them happy. I'm a gentleman too, though.
Yeah. Oh, I believe that. Yeah. I bet you're probably really kind of actually pretty sweet too.
Yeah, I keep, and I'm a big teddy bear. That like to just cuddle and lay on my chest. I got my hand on the butt cheek. They like it.
That's about, yeah.
They like the other things. Cause I got experience at what I do. They like that.
Is that right?
Oh yeah, they love. I get them hooked.
Yeah.
Every girl I ever dated had a serious relationship. They proposed to me. They want to get married. No lie. I'm serious.
Really? That good?
La mama, I be putting it down.
Oh my God.
Yeah, I be howling in the bedroom. Ain't no woman ever had that. I be biting and howling. Look, what woman have that?
Women who have been with you, apparently.
They know about it. Where they gonna get that from? They ain't never had that. They be like, well, ain't nobody never did this. I be making up my own positions. I used to want to be a porn star before everything, but when I was a kid, when I was 10 years old.
Yeah, I was gonna say every guy that, how old were you when you found your first lady?
I'm not putting that out there.
No. No.
I ain't lied to you yet.
That's young. Someone took advantage?
No.
Oh, you went?
Yeah. Well, I'm not talking about
that. Wow. All right. Wow. Well, yeah. Quinton, yeah, things just got a little.
That's a whole nother.
I do hope, in all seriousness, I hope you're writing a book or something.
I will one day.
You know, because you have a lot of stories and you have a, you know.
I just been holding everything back. I haven't been telling everybody.
Yeah.
The thing is, I don't know if the fans really ready to know the full Quinton. I don't think they're ready. Because people, like, they already judge me. They see me and they already judge me. People don't know how to take me and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. They don't really take time to think like, well, maybe he might be just like us.
Sometimes he might be kidding and sometimes he might just be having fun and sometimes it's serious.
They don't know. Yeah. I could be joking around, I could be this and they don't know. I'm just like everybody else. I like to have fun, I like to joke around.
Yeah.
I'm not too serious as a person. I would go out the way to get some laughs and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, I'm a human being.
Yeah. Well, you've always shown us great hospitality, you and Dave and the whole team here. Everybody's real good. And
yeah, we love you guys.
Yeah, you're awesome.
Mostly you.
Well, thanks. I wish you the best of luck in your next fight and with your promotion and the movies and everything. It's all good, Quinton. It's good to see you again.
Always good to see you.
Hey, now. That's a wrap.